Oh, just me.
Good day. In the 90s, first-person shooting was personified by id Software and 3D Realms. Every game those two companies put out back in the 90s was a goddamn masterpiece. And when you licensed an id Software engine, odds were your game was going to be a masterpiece, too. And today, we're taking a look at a game that was sold by 3D Realms that would be a masterpiece that would sadly be forgotten, sort of, over the years. A game that is not nearly as popular as it should be, but was remembered despite many difficulties. That's right, ladies and gentlemen, today we're taking a look at Blood! Blood's development initially began at Q Studios, an independent developer funded by 3D Realms. 3D Realms then sold off Blood to Monolith Studios. When released, Blood garnered some popularity, but alas, it did not get quite as popular as Duke Nukem 3D or Shadow Warrior 1. Back in the 90s, I personally never saw it for sale anywhere, and I never even saw it advertised. And it was likely not advertised altogether that much, due to its, shall we say, ultra-violence. And, to make matters worse, long after it was released, there were no source ports. Why, you might ask? Well, it seems that Monolith, unlike id Software, does not like to release its source code, and thus no source ports could actually be developed until fairly recently, and the only reason those could be developed was because many people have now been reverse engineering the source code. Despite both of those issues, Blood was able to maintain a remarkable level of popularity throughout the years, even at times when copies of the game were scarce. I would finally learn of Blood's existence from a fan in 2012, and I would acquire the game on GOG. Now today, all the gameplay footage we're going to be looking at is from the In Blood source port. So with that, let's take a look at Blood. Blood is a first-person shooter of the highest caliber. Health is limited, and health power-ups are few and far between. The enemies are varied, and of a really cool gothic horror design. The music is atmospheric and sets an absolutely chilling atmosphere that is quite at odds with other action-oriented FPSs of the 90s, and is only rivaled by id Software's Quake. The sound design is also nothing short of exceptional, with the enemies having creepy sounds when they attack you, and sometimes hilarious sounds as well. The graphics are pretty good by build engine standards, and are highly detailed, and Blood, like Shadow Warrior, makes use of voxels! Oh my god! The levels are quite good, and they are filled to the brim with excellent detail, and have good secrets, and have some very impressive architecture, and they have a large degree of interactivity, and thankfully, they are not all bloody mazes. Sure, as this is a 90s game, there are a couple here and there, but they're nowhere near as bad as they could be. They do test your observation skills, as switches will be placed in plain sight, but they will not be telegraphed from across the map. Take, for example, M1, E2. After killing everything and collecting all the keys, the game does not give you a single clue as to what you are supposed to do. When I first played Blood, I got frustrated and abandoned the game for a couple months until I got lucky and accidentally noticed that the ship's wheel had a key symbol by it. Clicking on it causes a bit of the ice to blow up for some reason, and then the exit is revealed. When I finally figured out how easy it was to complete that level, I wanted to burn that game to a disc and then use that disc as a goddamn sporting clay!
Monolith took a page from Raven Software and made the levels a part of the challenge. And like in the Jedi Knight games, you will run around a level for hours only to realize that the solution was right in front of your face the whole bloody time. Be patient, and look everywhere, and in theory, you will be able to figure it out. Or you can be lazy like me and type in no clip.
So now, let's take a look at the boomsticks and other assorted implements of violence.
You start the game with a pitchfork, and it's a weapon that is actually better than you might think. It pokes things in the worst possible way. It will take several hits to down the Deadites, and it's kind of useless against the cultists, seeing as how they have fucking guns. This game wants to give you a serious, serious challenge. Ammo is rather scarce. And that means that Blood is less of a run-and-gun action game and more of a first-person survival horror game, where you have to husband your ammo and use it wisely. The pitchfork might be a bit weak, but it does allow you to conserve your ammo, so be sure to learn how to circle strafe. Your first projectile weapon is a flare pistol. It is a one-hit kill for weaker enemies, but beware, it does take some time for an enemy to catch fire. You then get a boomstick. This weapon is indispensable. It takes down enemies fast, and ammo can usually be found for it in decent quantities, and it's best used against cultists. Also, this weapon model would later be used in the Doom 3 weapon mod for Doom 1993. Then you have the trench broom, the annihilator, the one, the only, M1928 Thompson submachine gun. It's quite good at taking down the basic foot soldiers, and ammo is slightly more plentiful than the shoddy, but still, this weapon should be used very sparingly. Then there is the bundle of dynamite. It's useful for taking out groups of enemies, and early game, taking out ranged enemies. Then you got the napalm launcher. It's this game's rocket launcher, and it is absolutely excellent, and is useful against groups of enemies and bosses. Next, you have the Tesla gun, and it does a good job blasting the bastards. Then you got the oh-so-fun spray paint can, and it is great fun for frying cultists. You got the voodoo doll. It's fucking hardcore, and just eradicates foes. The BFG for the game is this giant skull staff that wrecks just about everything and would be so popular that numerous Doom mods would utilize it. The various weapons all have alt-fire modes, and they are really only of situational usefulness and should be used sparingly to conserve ammo. The implements of ultra-violence are nothing short of epic tier. They are fun to use and are
actually bloody useful.
And the devs were competent enough to ensure that the player actually had reason to use the quirky weapons instead of relying on just the shoddy. And the developers were also competent enough, in addition to that, to include a bloody shotgun so that the player could use a weapon they were comfortable with. Of the build engine games, I actually prefer Blood's weapons the most, as they are the most visceral and downright fun of the lot.
Now it's time to load up that double barrel, gas up that chainsaw, and take a look at the story.
By 1997, cutscenes were becoming more and more common, and Blood actually has them. And they look entirely like pixelated crap. In the game, you play as this rather hilarious-looking bundle of pixels named Caleb. He is an undead cowboy that, alongside his gang of reprobates, fought in the name of the Great Satan. Satan, being a rather duplicitous bastard, betrays Caleb and his gang. He kidnaps Caleb's girlfriend named Ophelia and kills the rest. Caleb awakes in a shallow grave and sets out on a gruesome adventure to get his revenge. Blood has a fairly simple story that was, in the 90s and today, quite different from the norm. Caleb is not a heroic character and is not fighting to save the world in any way. This is a very dark game, no matter the era, but it's not grimdark, and it's not 12-year-old boy edgy dark.
Okay, maybe it is a little bit.
It's 95% Evil Dead dark. You can tell that the devs were big fans of the Evil Dead trilogy, as most of the enemies are quite reminiscent of the Deadites, and the slightly comedic tinge to the horror is very similar to the tone of Evil Dead 1 and 2. The levels for the game are of an indeterminate Lovecraftian time period, filled with little bits of humor here and there, but they are actually quite creepy, and the entire game has a weird horror-comedy duology feel to it. It's hard to tell if you're supposed to be laughing or you're supposed to be scared, and you can kind of feel both at the same time while playing. The cutscenes only manifest at the end of each boss encounter, and they are generally quite simple and usually just show Caleb gloating over his defeated foe. Caleb is the single most unsung 90s FPS character. He is quite simply cool incarnate.
Like with Duke and Shadow Warrior, Blood keeps the voice acting to a minimum, but what we do get kinda blows both Duke and Lil Wang out of the 2D gaming water.
Caleb is played by Stephen White, a voice actor who is sadly more obscure than he deserves to be. In Blood, he actually tries, and he turns in an almost film-grade performance. No joke, just have a listen.
Fresh victims for the ever-growing army of the undead.
Yes, that is actual voice acting from a campy-ish first-person shooter. That is the epicness of Blood.
Stephen White didn't just voice Caleb, he was also the voice of another epic monolith character, Captain Claw. Caleb is a joy to listen to and is yet another great aspect of the game, and really gives Caleb one more memorable attribute on top of being an undead Satan-worshipping cowboy. Oddly, Mr. White also can sound suitably dramatic. At the end of episode 1, you find that Ophelia has literally been crucified, and Caleb has this response.
Usually a no can come off as both campy and cringy, but Caleb's no actually feels like it has anguish to it. The voice actor actually puts effort into making a no sound good. Yes, Blood is one of the true unsung games of all time.
Eventually, you blast through enough cultists and demonic hellbeasts to finally face the big Papa S himself, as you would expect. You kill Satan, but what happens after is the most creative and hilarious bit. Now that is what I call a chaotic evil protagonist. He killed Satan, and when someone tries to thank him, he blows them the fuck away. And that's why FPS fans love them some Caleb. The story, while basic, subverts expectations in a good way, thank you very much, Rian Johnson, and actually does something creative with its protagonist and world. In 1997, developers had the freedom to pretty much do what they wanted and could get away with making a game that thought outside the general audience's box. And thus, despite all its challenges, Blood has remained in the popular consciousness to the point where there are fans of the game born many years after its release.
Surprise! I didn't really like it that much when I first played it.
Blood is not your average 90s first-person shooter. Rather, the devs wanted to give you a challenge. A challenge even harder, oh yes, than what Duke and Wang gave you. For you see, Caleb is the hardest of them all.
Well, if he's undead, technically his blood is not constantly circulating through his body, meaning that, well, Caleb should be the least hard.
For those who have not played Duke Nukem or Shadow Warrior, those two games are Duke Nukem on Viagra hard. Much harder than Doom 1993 by far. As a kid, I could barely beat Duke Nukem 3D on the lowest difficulty setting. Blood is another kettle of fish entirely. The enemy do a crap ton of damage to you, meaning that you will need to master the quicksave key to get any bloody wear in the game. This combined with the rather complicated level layout made me stop playing the game after about 15 minutes. But I eventually persevered and finished episode 1, and then didn't play the game for about 5 years. But after the release of the In Blood source port, I finally sat down and played the entire Blood e-game, and finally got the appeal and appreciated the excellence of Blood. At first, the game will be rather aggravating, but eventually with enough patience and practice, you will get used to the difficulty, and then you'll be blasting bastards with wild abandon. Getting this game to work in 2019 is way easier than it was back in 2013 when I first played it. I bought the game on GOG, and in its default layout, it's borderline unplayable, with a terrible screen resolution and tank controls. The only way to fix those back in the day was to edit the INI file. Thankfully, in the intervening time, a couple of source ports have been released. You have Blood GDX, which uses a Java runtime kind of thing to make Blood work, and it works decently enough. And then you have In Blood, which is what we're looking at today, and it works quite well as well. Really, when it comes down to source ports, both Blood GDX and In Blood are pretty much equivalent to one another. They do all the things you would want from a source port, such as widescreen high resolution and modern-day controls. One thing that is rather odd about In Blood is it actually sets the mouse sensitivity to a rather low level, so you'll definitely want to go in and manually change that so the game is not too sluggish. In this year, Night Drive Studios released Blood Fresh Supply. They reverse engineered the source code and finally put out an official re-release. And it works much like Shadow Warrior Redux. However, I have heard that there are a couple of glitches here and there.
Blood would receive a sequel in the guise of Blood 2. Sadly, I have not gotten that boss into work, no matter how many computers I've used. So, I have no idea if it's good or bad or not. However, I have seen a number of reviews on this particular game, and it definitely appears to be scheisse. But what is not scheisse, and instead wunderbar, is indeed the modern-day game inspired by Blood, Dusk.
Dusk was released in 2018 and is nothing short of transcendent, and one day I shall review it. It features many of the aesthetic qualities of Blood and features a story and concepts similar to Blood as well, although the game is a bit more fair due to enemies using projectiles instead of abominable hitscan weapons. Sadly, the protagonist Dusk Dew does not talk, which means Dusk has a little less personality than Blood, but overall it does a great job of making the concept of a dark shooter live again.
I highly recommend giving Blood a go, if you're hard enough. And so, I am General Ott, wishing you good Far Cry 3 Blood Dragon, and good Wolfenstein Old Blood, or whatever makes you happy.
If you enjoyed this video, please consider subscribing, and if you can, please consider supporting me on Patreon so that I can continue bringing you this awesome content.